بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيد الأنبياء والمرسلين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين ما بعد. Inshallah, this is going to be a series of discussions on the role of the Imam in the community, how important that is, how to break that down, how to understand it, what are the different roles that he actually plays, and how to deal with some of the challenges that that role entails and how to overcome those particular challenges. So the first thing that I think is very important to discuss is, what does the word imam mean? Where does it come from? What is the root of that? And there are a number of definitions that I can go through, but I'm not going to spend a lot of time with them. If you go back to the linguistic definitions, whether that be from al-Qamus al-Muhit or from al-Siha, they all come from the root amma ya'ummu imaman, and the root of that, all of that has to do with basically is the leader, the person who is to be followed. Within a religious connotation, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he actually uses the word imam. فَانْتَقَمْنَا مِنْهُمْ وَإِنَّهُمَا لَبِإِمَامٍ مُبِينٍ. And we took retribution on them. Both are still there on the highway plane for all to see. So the word imam here is meant to be a path, or a clear path that is meant to be followed. Again, falling in line very much with the linguistic connotation. There are a number of scholars that we can refer to in this regard. You have Mawardi, Juwaini, Imam al-Nasafi, al-Iji, Ibn Khaldun. All of them talk about it more in a political sense, who the imam is. And when they talk about that, it's more of a governing body, a person who is in a political position. So while these definitions, they do give us general insight into what a religio-political figure might be and what he would be responsible for within an Islamic state, it doesn't really uncover what the scope is that we're discussing today, and the series, and what is the purpose behind it. Because there is a very particular archetype that many of us Muslims have concerning who the imam is, what it is that he does, and what his particular roles are. Another use that us as Muslims in general can have concerning the imam is somebody who has had a large impact on the Muslim community, and you know, the four imams being from them and other imams from Islamic history. And so we call all of those individuals imams. The one who leads the congregational prayers, regardless of his level of knowledge, regardless of his impact, he will always be known and always be called the imam. Within a social connotation, this is where you start having differences amongst the different communities. So if you look in the archetypal understanding of the imam, like we had mentioned before, within the immigrant population, so the people who have actively immigrated here to the United States, and this is pretty much where I'm going to frame my discussion. I don't know too much about the rest of the Western world, so how he's viewed in England and France or in Australia, New Zealand, in the rest of the Western world, I'm not particularly familiar with. I will talk about within the framework here in the United States. In general, the imam to such a person, such an immigrant, would be somebody who dresses Eastern, somebody who might not speak English particularly well, but he will speak the language of his target audience, or whatever that community's native tongue might be, whether it be Kurdish or Urdu or Punjabi or Arabic. He has a very ritual involvement, and again, I will define what I mean by ritual involvement and ritual roles. He is generally a custodian of cultural norms and understanding. So he's there basically to reinforce what their cultural understanding of a particular religious rite or religious custom might be. Some immigrant communities view the role of the imam as very employee-employer type. So he is basically delegated particular roles, and he is to fulfill them according to whatever the employer demands from him. And he's also held to a higher standard. So, you know, he publicly cannot dress a certain way. He publicly cannot speak a certain way. He publicly cannot be involved in certain conversations or in certain social events. For the first generation now, which is the sons and daughters of that immigrant community, that dynamic changes a little bit. Some of them might hold on to those particular values, but some of them don't have as much importance as they did for that for those active immigrants. He has more of a social role. And again, this is something I'm going to define further later on in the series, inshallah, in addition to those ritual roles that I had mentioned before for the immigrant community. So again, the first generation, they might not hold those immigrants' mentalities concerning what those particular roles are, but the social role to them is something that is extremely important. They view him as a religious resource, somebody who they can go back to in terms of as a spiritual guide. Some of them might even view him as a friend, or as an educator, depending, again, on his role within the community and what it is that he does. he himself, what his status is, how he's able to communicate, how he's able to carry himself, how much he's able to relate to the community. Sometimes you have an imam who can very much relate to the immigrants, but it's very difficult for him to relate to the first generation, and vice versa. The other community that I'm not going to talk about too much is the indigenous community, which is whether black, white, or Spanish American. I'm not very familiar with those communities. I can only speak on the immigrant community, being myself from an immigrant community. But from what I have seen, I can't imagine their needs being drastically different from the first generation community. And the reason for that is because they're very much American. Practically, what does the imam do? And here there are a list of jobs that he does. He leads the prayers, he delivers the khutbas, he provides marriage counseling, he provides legal counseling, he can provide therapy or just general counseling, provides youth mentorship, does research, he gives fatwa, in religious rulings. He is an educator. He is the social or professional network guide of the community, and he's the financial aid director. So I've listed about 11 jobs here that the imam is expected to do, dependent on the community. Leading the prayer, this is the classical archetypal imam. The one who gives the khutbah is a khatib. The one who provides marriage counseling is obviously a marriage counselor, provides legal counseling. He would be a mustashar shari, or a Islamic legal advisor. Giving therapy or counseling, this is the job of a therapist. Youth mentorship, this is usually what a youth coordinator or a guidance counselor does. He does research, this is what an academic does. He gives religious rulings, this is generally what a mufti does. Being an educator, whether it be on the lower grades or on the undergraduate or graduate level, this would be the job of either a teacher or a professor. Being a social or professional network guide, this is usually what people use Google or LinkedIn or other clergy from other faith traditions for. Financial aid director, and this is usually the job of a social worker. So this job is very, has a lot of requirements, and there are a lot of needs within the community that need to be fulfilled. Do they need to be fulfilled by this one particular individual? That is up for debate and that is up for discussion, and which is why I'm presenting this series here. There are many elements that are unique to the position of the imam. So one of the main elements that are unique to that is that it is both his professional and his social space. So he will go there professionally because he has a job to fulfill, and it'll also be a social space where he might meet his friends. He might meet other colleagues. He might meet other people. He will go there on his days off, which is not very common in other fields and in other jobs. Something, again, to keep in mind and something that we'll further expand and discuss on. There are a lot of issues that the imam faces in terms of his educational background. Most imams that have a classical or traditional education, if you will, they are trained to be researchers, they're trained to be academics, they're trained to be jurists, they're not trained to be imams. Experience, most imams lack experience when they finish their seminaries. There aren't a lot of internship opportunities that I am I'm aware of, unfortunately. And this is something, and this is a space that we definitely should open up. There are a lot of skills gaps that the imam has. Many times he is not qualified for mentorship. Many times he is not qualified to counsel. Many times he is not qualified even for public speaking, something that we would expect from him based on him being a khatib. Project management is a big lacking. He does not know how to delegate different projects and how to organize them. Nonprofit management, which has many unique aspects in and of itself. Even understanding what nonprofit means and what the difference is between that and for-profit organizations. All of these are missing from an imam's training regiment, and it's very unfortunate and something that I believe is fundamental for him to be an effective imam. There is also a time gap, meaning that many times when an individual goes overseas or go for traditional study path, he will be away from his home country for a number of years. Even I was away for over a decade. And this really became an issue. This really became a problem. And this is something that should be recognized, because when you have a time gap, there's a huge cultural gap, and there's something that is definitely missing from that imam's regiment, because he's been away from that culture for so long. He's not given a time, in relation to that time, he's not given time to reflect on the knowledge that he's actually taken in. So it's very easy to have a huge intake of all this knowledge. There are a number of courses, a number of outside classes that a particular individual might attend, but actually sitting down and getting time to review a lot of that information, many of us don't have that. And the first time we're able to actually sit down and review is when we're back in the seat or in the chair of the imam. And by that time, I don't want to say it's too late, But you are playing a game of catch up. You know, you're trying to catch up with all the information. You're trying to digest all the information that you had, but you're trying to practically apply it at the same time. And this can be very, and it is extremely challenging. There are other issues that the individual imam will face in terms of financial planning, in terms of family planning. And these are things that I will discuss in the final lecture, inshallah, in the series on how to, you know, what this person can actually do and what are some things he can do to help financially plan for himself, how he can plan for his family. I'm sure many of you out there who are looking to get into the dawah field are very curious about this particular position. And there are challenges. Many of us have, you know, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 plus children, and how to deal with that, how when we come back to the U.S., you know, how is it that we reintegrate them into society? Because for many of us, it's easy. We come from this society and we're coming back home, quote unquote. But for some of us, there is a huge cultural gap, meaning that our children might have been raised in that place that we were studying. And then this is actually foreign land to them. Making that adjustment, making that transition is definitely a big challenge. So in summary, what is the role of the imam? And if I had to summarize it, I would summarize it into three. He has a ritual role, he has a social role, and he has a civil role. Each of these I will discuss in detail, inshallah, in some of the upcoming talks, some of the upcoming lectures. But just in summary, the ritual role involves this individual leading daily prayers, giving the khutbas, khatiras, making dua for special occasions, specific duties during Ramadan, and holding quote-unquote Islamic classes. His social role revolves more around marriage counseling, youth counseling, networking by going out to events within the community, speaking at other masajid, being available socially to his community. We'll talk about availability versus accessibility, inshallah, next time when I talk about the social role. Professionally networking, I think that's something that's very important also. And lastly, his civil role. And this civil role entails a number of things. And under the civil role, I include interfaith, I include dawah. So if an individual goes out and sets up a dawah booth, I believe it falls under the civil role that he has. Getting involved with local government, I think, is something that's very important, something that's very much overlooked. Again, something I will talk about more in detail. Getting involved with local law enforcement, I think that's something, again, that's very important. Child protection services, why that is important and why we need to have a relationship with them. Getting involved on a federal level, whether it be the FBI or Homeland Security, how we get involved with them, to what extent should we utilize them as resources and services. And again, we'll talk about all of these roles in detail and very much specifically on what each of these entails and what that means to me, at least. And I will talk about why it is that I'm presenting him in the particular order. But if you asked me what is the most important role of the imam out of these three, I would say that the social role is the one that is the most important out of all of the three. And I will discuss in detail why it is that I believe that. And number two, I would say his civil role. And lastly, I would say out of the least important of these three would be his ritual role. Not to diminish that role in any way, shape, or form. It is important, but I believe these two supersede that. And again, I will talk about all of these things. I look forward to seeing you all of you next time, inshallah, for the next lecture. Wallahu a'lam wa sallallahu ala khayri khalqin, nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam.